मॉर्निंग सर।
इज वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग, वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग निर्मल, योर टीम इज रेडी।
यस सर, टीम इज रेडी। शैल वी स्टार्ट?
निर्मल इज, आई थिंक निर्मल हैज टू जॉइन, देयरफॉर आई रिक्वेस्ट द पास्ट बैच टू कंटिन्यू द सेशन। आचित, आचित नायक, निशांत सरवणन।
Yes, sir. So I'm in Nirmal's batch. We
oh,
are
you
ready.
You are belongs to Nirmal batch.
Yeah.
Okay, your team
I think
is
most
ready.
Of our members. Yeah, most of us have joined.
Yes. Okay.
Okay, then
go
I
ahead
you,
with
sir?
Your presentation. I request
okay.
The eighth batch to continue the session. Is the session to you all to take the session and present your content.
Can you see my screen, sir? Is my screen visible?
Yes, yes, Nishant.
Okay. So a very good morning to one and all present here. Today, my group and I will be presenting to you about the recent development in advanced robotics. So robots are used for assembling products, handling dangerous materials, cutting, polishing, inspection of products, and used for a number of things. And a number of robots are used in tasks as diverse as cleaning sewers, detecting bombs, and performing intricate surgery is increasing steadily and will continue to grow in the coming years. Robots are applied in various technologies like medical field, education, computer science, etc., etc. So now, without further ado, I'd like to hand it over to Pradeep to begin the presentation.
Good morning, everyone and all here. I'm here to continue with the SWAM robotics. Okay, next slide. Nishan, next slide. Yeah, what is SWAM in general means? SWAM is a behavior, or swarming is a collective behavior exhibited by entities, particularly animals of a smaller size, which aggregates together, perhaps in milling about the same spot, or perhaps moving in masses or migrating in some direction. Then what is meant by SWAM robotics means? SWAM robotics is a field of multi-robotics in which a large number of robots are coordinated and distributed in a decentralized way. It's based on a use of local rules and simple robots compared to complexity of task achieving and inspired by social inserts. Large number of simple robots can perform a complex task in a more efficient way than a single robot, giving a robustness and a flexibility to the group. Some of the common properties seen in natural swarms are decentralization and autonomous local communication. That is, individual member of the swarms only communicate with the neighboring entities. Then cooperative behavior that emerges through the self-organization. This swarms behavior generally seen in repairing damage to the nest, or foraging for food, or caring for brood. Okay, then next slide. As I said, a simple robotic swarm acquires a characteristic of social inserts, which are listed as follows. So the swarm must be autonomous, that it should take decision, or sometimes it should take decision on its own, and it should have some self-control, and it should properly act in a real environment. Robots count must be enough to complete the assigned tasks, complete the task. Then a homogeneity should be there, but the minimum amount of difference is allowed inside the group. Single robot cannot achieve the target, so the cooperative behavior is needed, and some coordination is needed for the better performance. The robot's sensors and communication with the local neighbors, this ensures distributed coordination and scalability of the system. That is, that it is expected only to communicate with the neighbor and take decision based on the action of the neighboring robots. Thus, swarm intelligence in general is artificial intelligence based on collective behavior of decentralized and self-organized system. It has mainly two algorithms, ant colony optimization and flocking algorithm. Next slide. What is ant colony optimization means? It's based on a real ant colony behavior and useful in solving optimization problems. The ant colony algorithm is finding optimal path that is based on the behavior of ant searching for food. At first, the ant wander randomly. When an ant finds a source of food, it walks back to the colony, leaving markers that show the path that has a food. That you can see in the diagram given below. The flocking algorithm. What is flocking algorithm means? Just take an example. A flock of birds flying with a sink. Something called which is called emigrant behavior. This emigrant behavior is when all individual elements is in a scene follow a set of simple rules, and this in turn give rise to surprisingly complex behavior to the group of elements as a whole. In this case of flocking birds, the examples rules are try to move in the same direction, stick together, don't fly into each other. The birds flocking algorithms are created by Krier-Greenhalgh in 1986. Each of the birds just follows just simple three rules, and what result is some complex, seemingly choreographed movement of the flock as a whole. What's surprising is in fact that each of the individual birds decides its action only considering the few birds within its local perception radius. Okay. Next slide, please. And now let's look at what are the techniques involved in the swarm robotics. The basic and main thing is aggregation. What does it mean is getting all the robots together and exchanging basic information and what are the collective movement that it should undergo. Then is a dispersion of robots after aggregation, which means that and the robot should be given exact coordinates for its initial position and to start its movement. And in this almost all the robots will act as a single sensor for the group. Then the important thing is a formation of pattern. It's a major portion when a task needs contribution from one or more robots. Then collective movements. It's a way of coordinating group, making them move in a cohesive way on the task. Then allocating tasks. It's a process of dividing the robots and allocating tasks individually to them. Then one important thing is searching for source. It's done in two ways, mostly global and local, classified based on the communication between them. And then transporting of objects. If the object is too heavy, the robots coordinate itself to transport the object. Then collective mapping. It's a mapping done by all robots to cover a large areas and share among other robots. Then categories of them. Next slide, please. Then a categories of swarm is mostly two categories only. One is master and one is slave. The master control all the swarm robots. Only one master will be there for a group, and decisions are made in a critical condition by the master only. And there is a primary function is to guide other robots. And slave robots are controlled by master. And apart from master, every robots are slave robots, and they do the task allocated by master, and they can't think on their own. The basic parts of swarms are microcontroller and motors and sensors. The benefits and disadvantages are swarm robots are adaptable, evolvable, boundless, novelty. But disadvantages are non-optimal, non-controllable, non-predictable, non-understandable, and non-immediate. Can't take action on such immediate situations. Then advantages of multi-robotic systems over a single robot. First one is task parallelism. The tasks are decomposed and distributed for the efficient performance among all robots. Then task enablement. The things can be achieved by group of robots which cannot be done by a single robot. Then distribution in sensing. That is every robot in a group act as a single individual sensor, so that range of sensing is increasing. Distribution in action is action can be done by different robots at different place at same time. Then fault tolerance is failure of one robot will not affect the group from accomplishing the task. Then next slide, please. Then the terminologies are related to swarm robotics are collective sizes. That means how many robots should be allocated for accomplishing the tasks. Then communication ranges. The robots can, that is, the robot each and individual robot will communicate only to the neighboring robot and also takes decisions based on the signals given by the neighboring robots. Then communication tropology, mostly the tropology is used as a graph, general graph tropology. Then a communication bandwidth, communication cost between the two robots is same as moving the robots between the location. Then a collective refusability, reconfigurability, this is the coordinate arrangement within the members that communicates. Then a processing ability, it is where the computational model is turning machine equivalent. Then a last,
Pradeep, try to converge within 5 minutes, Pradeep. It was very, very fine. Try to converge within 5 minutes.
Okay, sir. Then the last thing is collective composition, meaning that the robots are homogeneous. Then the final topic is what's the future of swarm robotics? So swarm robotics developing field like anything, and it's majorly contributing in material delivery, precision farming, 3D printing, surveillance, defense, search operation, and many others. And a couple of issues to be noted is development of robust algorithm models to communication and also making the production feasible for economically feasible for the users. And thank you, my friend Manishan will continue with the next topic.
Yes, just a minute, Pradeep. Go back. Go back. Still. Yes, any other, go back. Yes, how this picture is related to our discussion, Pradeep?
It's a coordinated communication between the robots, sir. How they are one master robot and one slave robots, and how it's guiding the other robots to form certain shapes and completing the task.
What would be the difference between the master robot and slave robot, Pradeep?
It's the decision. It's a decision taking one, and the other will obey the decision and do what it says.
Okay, good. What was the hardware which we are going to install in the master robot, which is not there in the slave robot?
I think that it's differences in algorithm that it's used, I think.
Okay. It is not algorithm, I tell you. You are talking about swarm. In the name itself, we have some other algorithm. Have you heard about it? Any other algorithm which the name itself has swarm?
Yes,
we have PSO, Particle Swarm Optimization. One type of algorithm is available that is renowned, and in recent research that was found as a superior algorithm, Particle Swarm Optimization. You are good. Your presentation is very fine. Concerning the ion colony algorithm, flocking algorithm, Dal, it is beyond our scope. Still, your attempt is fine towards this algorithm. Go ahead.
Hello. Good morning. My name is Manisharan. Until now, my friend has explained about swarm robot. Now, let us see some latest developments in robotics. First, let us see about Kubo robot. This is an educational robot which helps students above three ages in educational system. It is a world of puzzle-based educational robot, and it makes coding and other education simple as jigsaw puzzle. These robots teaches coding, language, music, maths, and many other things for kids in a simple way. It helps primary and pre-primary school children to explore and understand things very easily. This is a very pretty robot. It is about the size of a Coca-Cola can with two wheels at the bottom, and it moves to and fro on the table. Next slide. This beside diagram shows the parts of the Kubo robot, and it has many parts like head to clip in the body. This picture shows the parts of the Kubo robot. And as this Kubo robot is already available in Kubo website, but there are different types of kits available for those. The basic kit is programming kit, and the more advanced programming kit also available. The kit for parts around the alphabets and the kit for mathematical numbers. Next slide, please. And this is about Cooper robot. And now let's see about another robots. The robots which play soccer for RoboCup. RoboCup is an international robotic competition which was started in 1997. And the aim of this RoboCup is to promote robotics and AI technology all over the world. These robots can also compete with humans in few more years. The main concept of this is to promote robotics in every field. Next slide, please. And every year this tournament are organized like FIRA RoboCup. At present, the RoboCup consists of various leagues like small size, medium size, four large, four league, and humanoid. Thank you. From here, my friend will continue the presentation.
Good morning all, myself Nishok. So next up we'll see micro truck. Really tiny objects because of they don't weigh very much and they flip a lot like those of a micro truck board can drag something over 2000 times its own weight. That same as you pull the blue whale. If you were to look at the bottom of the robot under a microscope, you could see a bunch of tiny little rubber hairs. As you pulled it off them, they stick to a surface, and as you let it go up, pulling, they pop right back off, and all these tiny little hairs, rubber hairs, are on the bottom of the layer of the robot and the pieces of the robot that allows us to decide when we want to stick to the ground and when we want to walk around. You can see it includes a battery pack on the top of the brain and a winch and a spool that can reel it in the weight that the microscope. And finally, a rope that can be attached to whatever the robot wants to pull. And now it looks like the parts that make the robot actually to move front end has an arm with two motors attached to it and let the robot drive straight. Next slide, please. However, it wants to put it in all together and watch it run. Turn the robot as it blows its parts onto the ground and pulls on its rope and picks it up and drives forward and then lowers again. Pulls the rope and picks up, drives forward, and by doing it over and over, it's be able to move the chain weight by a long distance. Next slide, please. And this is again a biomimicry robot called RoboBee. Insects are true masters of flight, small and light in weight, and highly maneuverable. Scientists have been taking inspiration from six-legged insects to try and create flying robots of the same size. But it's proven difficult because when you get down to the insect scale, it's hard to generate enough thrust to carry your own source power. But there is a new robot in the town that's creating a bit of buzz. These are the new kind of robots called RoboBee X-Wing. It has got a wingspan of just 3.5 centimeters, and it's about a quarter of the weight of the paperclip. At this scale, batteries are just too heavy to carry it on board. So the researchers used ultra lightweight solar cells. These generate power and send it to a control board that operates a pair of piezoelectric actuators. Clever materials that work a bit like a muscle and contract when the voltage passes across them. By sticking actuators together, they bend back and forth to flap the bird wings. These seminal flights lasted for less than a second and required more than twice the energy contained in the sunlight. But they represent an important milestone for flight at this scale, and they supersede the thrust efficiency of the living insects. There's certainly still a room for improvement. The aerodynamics of the wings are not as efficient as the real insects. And of course, the controls that the insects pack into the tiny compact brain are a long way off the RoboBee. But this model produced more thrust than it needed, and in future that could be used to carry controls and sensors. The hope is that these miniature robotic insects will one day be able to achieve continuous outdoor flight and help the environment and disaster monitoring. Thank you.
So drones. Outer space, hurricane disaster zones, Antarctica, your front door. One of these destinations is a little less extreme than the others. But that's the point for drones. A drone, in technological terms, is an unmanned aircraft. Originally, drones are known as unmanned aerial vehicles. It is a flying robot that can be remotely controlled or fly autonomously through software-controlled flight plans in their embedded systems, working in conjunction with the onboard sensors and GPS. An embedded system is a microprocessor-based computer hardware system with software that is designed to perform a dedicated function, either as an independent system or as a part of a large system. Now let's look at different types of drones. The first type of drone is a single rotor helicopter. The single rotor helicopters look exactly like a tiny helicopter, like the picture given here. They can be gas or electric powered. The single blade and ability to run on gas helps its stability and fly for longer distances. So these UAVs are usually used to survey land, research storms, and map erosion caused by global warming. The next type is the multi-rotor drones. Multi-rotor drones are usually some of the smallest and lightest drones in the market. They have limited distance, speed, and height, but make the perfect flying vehicle for enthusiasts and aerial photographers. These drones can usually spend 20 to 30 minutes in the air carrying a lightweight payload like a camera. The next type is the fixed-wing drones. The fixed-wing drones look like regular airplanes where the wings provide the lift instead of the rotors, making them very efficient. These drones usually use fuel instead of electricity, allowing them to glide in the air for more than 16 hours. Since these drones are generally much larger, they need takeoff and land on runways, just as airplanes do because of the design. The military uses fixed-wing UAVs to carry out strikes and by scientists to carry large amounts of equipment. So let's look at how the drones are used for. And since I don't have a lot of time, I'll only be telling a few of them. Firstly, we'll see the military use, which is probably the oldest, most well-known and controversial use of drones is in the military. The British and US military started using very basic forms of drones in the early 1940s to spy on Axis powers, which is Germany, Italy, and Japan, World War II. Today's drones are much more advanced than those UAVs, equipped with thermal imaging, laser range finders, and even tools to perform airstrikes. The most prominent one is today is the MQ-9 Reaper, which is given here. The aircraft measures 36 feet long. It can fly 50,000 feet in the air undetected and is equipped with a combination of missiles and intelligence gathering tools. Next, actually, let's see about delivery drones. They're usually autonomous UAVs that are used to transport food packages or goods at your doorstep. Retailers and grocery chains are all over the country are trying to turn drones as much more efficient delivery alternative instead of relying on delivery drivers with inefficient trucks. So these drones can carry an impressive 55 pounds of goods to your front door without you ever having to leave the house. Amazon, Walmart, FedEx, UPS, and many other big brands are currently testing different delivery drones. Nextly, let's look at the emergency rescue drones. So sometimes it's just not safe enough to send humans into a rescue situation due to the severity of the disaster. And that's where the drones come in. In the case of capsized boat or drowning individual, Officials can throw an autonomous underwater vehicle, an AUV, into the water to assist in the rescue. If there is an avalanche, the drones are deployed to look for those caught in the snow. Aircraft maker Command has developed a pilotless helicopter called the K-Max, which is here, given here, designed to carry more than 6,000 pounds of cargo. The K-Max has already been used in Australia to assist with the forest fires that have been going on. Lastly, for the photography, drones used for photography. So drones have been a boon for photographers who use the UAVs to capture gorgeous aerial photos. Ever wondered what it's like to get a bird's eye view of your favorite city? These drones are explicitly made for photography that provide a new way to photograph some of your favorite destinations from above. And I would like to end my part with a joke. So what's the difference between a Taliban fighter and an Afghan child? Don't ask me, I just pilot the drone. So nextly, Prasad will be talking to you about transparent hydrogen robots.
Okay. Hi, guys. Are you able to hear me? Yeah, okay. So I'll start now. So today we'll be seeing about transparent hydrogen robots. Nishan, next slide. So transparent hydrogen robots. These robots are fabricated transparent gel-based robots that move when water is pumped in and out of them. So these bots can perform a number of fast, forceful tasks, including kicking a ball underwater and grabbing and releasing a live fish. So these are the operations which can be performed by these robots. And also the robots are made entirely of hydrogel. So when it comes to hydrogel, it is a tough, rubbery and transparent in nature, and it is composed mostly of water. So each robot is an assemblage of hollow, precisely designed hydrogel structures. And also, like, if you pump water into hydrogel robots, the structure quickly inflates in orientation that enable the bots to curl up and stretch out its form. So, and also the team has fashioned several hydrogel robots, including a fin-like structure that flaps back and forth, an articulated appendage that makes kicking motions, and a soft-handed, hand-shaped robot that can squeeze and relax. So, next slide, Nishan. So, these are the points when it comes to transparent hydrogel robots. So, next slide. Yeah, robot technology. So when it comes to robot technology, it is a remote control robotic bird. It has the realistic appearance and weight of its living counterpart, which is an actual bird. So it looks similarly, like exactly like a bird. These robots flies by flapping its wing as a means of lift and propulsion. So there are a variety of applications for robot in robot technologies. So we use this in UAV daily in complex airspace and challenging environments across the globe. It works in aviation, waste management, dredging, agriculture, construction, and harbors. So anywhere birds possess a problem, it steps in to help. Sometimes a robot is even used for performances, television and film industries. So next slide, Nishan. Yeah. So and also, like, we can see there are when it comes to specification of these robot, it has a wingspan of approximately 1 meter, and it weighs around 750 to 800 grams, and it and flies between 2 to 4 minutes while hazing. And it is durable and light plastic composite body with internal mechanism and GPS. And it has cardboard composite for tail for remotely controlled steering. And next slide, Nishan. So robot technology is used in
What was KTS, Prasad?
Sir?
What was the meaning abbreviation of KTS?
Which one, sir?
Earlier slide. 20 to 25 kgs. What it means?
No, not sir. When. So, robot technology which is used in a film called Yuri Surgical Strike. So it is a Hindi movie, and so in this movie, like, we'll be seeing a spy robot named Garuda for spying the terrorist camps in Pakistan. To know about the outer design of the place and number of persons in the camp. So basically, it will be easier for the Indian Army to proceed this operation. So this robot technology helps in that mission. So these are about robot technologies used in movies. So next. Oh, okay.
Hello everyone, good morning. I am here to continue with latest robot technologies. First is the STAR robot. The abbreviation of STAR is Smart Tissue Autonomous Robot. In simple words, a STAR robot is a robotic arm that can stitch together soft tissues. A few years ago, the STAR proved it could stitch the soft tissue better than a experienced surgeon with high precision and accuracy. The stitches made by STAR robot are more regular and leak resistant. The STAR is really good at doing repetitive procedures that require a lot of precision. Yeah, once experienced surgeon said that if you miss one suture, for example, that may create a leak and cause problems, the STAR can prevent this from happening because it can perform this task precisely and without errors and each and every time. The STAR not only has tools for suturing, but also fluorescent and 3D imaging, force sensing, and sub-millimeter processing. It also demonstrated that it can make precise cuts in irregular soft tissue. Next slide. The idea behind making this robot is there is chances in making mistakes even for a experienced surgeon to avoid. After all, life is very important, so to avoid these small mistakes happening in surgeries, these type of robots were invented. The first image is the robot tracking the surface of a human head for operating. The tracking mechanism is given here. The STAR usually tracks its cutting path and cutting tool while adjusting to movement. Using its near infrared camera, it follows the tiny marks placed on the tissue before and to keep on the track during cutting. The next image is the elements of the robotic arm that does the suturing operation or 3D imaging, so on. Next slide. So these robots are very useful, but it can go wrong at any time. So proper governance is needed by an experienced surgeon at all time. Next is the social robots. I hope that everyone knows as the name suggests, everyone knows what it does. A social robot is a robot that interacts with humans and it can communicate. In workplaces, it can do almost every job, like greeting and taking over systems and according and giving the work accordingly. At home, it can be act as a member of a family itself, and it has some unique characteristic to mingle themselves along with the family. Some of the ways social robots are used today includes tutoring, that is teaching kids with a different interactive way. Next slide. Telepresence provide me remote meetings and for office works and conference calls and telecalls. It also acts as a companion for elders and kids. Specifically, once it is given with the proper product characteristics and timings of an office, it can provide the customers with information for information about that to customers. You may find this very frequently outside the various shops. Social robots can already be found in in few places. As the technology improves, it is set to play an important role in at all venues. Next slide. Now let us discuss about some of the social robots available so far. First one is the Anki robot. It is available in Amazon or Flipkart itself. It costs about 20,000. You can purchase it easily. It is built in with Alexa, so it can hear our commands and act accordingly. It can also give answers for the questions we ask. It can also capture photo and say with important dates whenever it is needed. It is pronounced as Aibo. In Japanese language, Aibo means partner. So it is like a dog, and it can be a partner for us. It is also built up with Alexa. It can hear our commands, and it is basically a dog. It's like an entertainment thing only. It cannot do any tasks or work. It plays with toys, responds to commands, and it can also identify different persons with this rear camera, so that it can act accordingly to the persons also. Next slide. It is also available in internet, and it costs about 2 lakhs. Next one is the Toyota robot. It is made by Toyota company. It is a series of humanoid robot developed by Toyota. It is a slightly advanced robot than Aibo and Anki. It not only performs household tasks, but also performs some advanced tasks like playing basketball and playing music, trumpets, and it can also play drums when it is programmed accordingly. There are totally 5 versions in it. The first version is the bipedal robot. The second one is the Segway-like wheels. Third one also has a Segway-like wheels. Fourth one has unique wire systems. And the fifth one, it is called as iFoot, which has 2 separate legs and almost it acts like a human itself. The next robot is SoftBank robot. They have also given a name for this. It is Pepper. Pepper is a semi-humanoid robot manufactured by SoftBank Robotics. The main characteristics of this robot is it can read emotions. This can be done by detecting and analyzing the facial expression and voice tones. It is built in itself, but these are not. It is not available easily to buy. Only few robots are available in world so far. Maybe we can hope so in future it will be available for everyone. After reading these topics, I get motivated to buy one of the robots. Hope you will also be motivated. If you for extra, you can search in internet. It was very exciting to see all these robots. Hope you will also see it. Thank you.
Yeah, hello guys. I am Prajesh Kumar. I'm going to explain about origami robot. First of all, the word origami means the Japanese sort of folding paper into decorative shapes and figures. But here the origami robots refers to the tiny shaped folded figures, but which can do some operations. You can simply say the actions are created by folding, right? Their bodies are made up of many dynamic folds that can act together to accommodate the mechanisms. we can even say simply a thin single planar sheet is folded into a 3D planar morphology. It can do some several operations, like it can walk, it can swim, and it can show some, or it can show some movement, and it can dissolve in some solvent, and it can disappear on degradation. So, but we cannot expect any proper usage from these robots. So researchers found ingestible origami robot. It's a type of origami robot. The researchers at MIT found that it has some benefits in medical field. So they demonstrated that it can be consumed as a tablet, which can be unfold itself in the stomach. So it can be controlled by external magnetic field, and its uses are it can crawl across the stomach wall to catch some wound or to remove some foreign items. Nishant, accelerator. Now we are going to see
yes,
about
just a minute, Pradish.
Yes.
Yes, go back to the last slide. Yes, what was the name of that solid robot?
Ingestible origami robot.
Ingestible origami robot. The purpose of this type of robot, Pradish?
Sir, if there is any wound in a stomach, or if there is any foreign items inside, we can remove it. Like when a button battery is swallowed by some children, we can remove it by ingestible organ robots. Like it can be controlled by external magnetic field, by you can move it. So
okay, how we can take it out from the stomach?
That's what I searching for, but I didn't get it out.
Like, okay, once you get you post. It was a nice topic too. Go ahead and search with the study, and if you got any information, you please post it in our team, because the gastroenterologist facing many issues regarding the wounds in stomach. If it is the ingestible origami is the solution, then it would be very fine. And it was very fine to have a visit over this origami robot. Anyway, go ahead with that and search it. And
so the name itself suggests indigestible, so it won't digest and come out.
Yes, Tathacharya. Yeah. Yes, it has to come, but in what way? That has to be studied. Yes, anyway, go ahead, Pratish.
Yes. Yeah. And we are going to see about exoskeletons. You can see in that picture that it can be wearable devices. These devices is used for the enhancement of physical performance of the wearer. This robot plays an important role for the person with some disabilities. There are variety of exoskeletons, and there are depends upon the beneficial use of the person. These exoskeletons will have some hydraulic sensors, levers, motors, etc. Depend upon the use. Many companies have released many type of exoskeletons, but it is not affordable for being citizen in India. Like it cost around 3 lakhs, because it should be made of lightweight and it should be strong, and it to make the wearer comfortable. That's it about exoskeletons and origami robot. I will know more about origami robot and I will post in the group. Then my following fellow mate Pooja will explain about robotics with artificial intelligence. Thank you.
Hello everyone, I am Pooja. I would like to continue this presentation. On this topic of recent development in advanced robotics, I selected robotics involving artificial intelligence and about their applications towards the future. So firstly, I would like to tell you what is AI. AI is intelligence demonstrated by machines, in which machines think, learn and evolutionize themselves, which involves facial recognition, gives us better decision-making strategies, text or voice recognition, and carry out very complex mechanisms automatically on its own. The kind of AI I was talking about is in the long, long way of the future, and we are in full force working and developing in the recent days. So is this development good, or is this a serious issue to be addressed? So let me tell you after we move on through the next few slides. But first things first, we will see some applications. As I've already specified a few applications already, and a lot more of them are there, we'll constrain ourselves only from a manufacturing engineering point of view. So, and if you could see the slide, in today's global manufacturing sectors, there are few main in which AI robots is deployed. So first thing is the assembly. In assembly, robots, AI robots are highly useful in assembling things. So if I take an example of aerospace, so assembling such complex parts for making a rocket could make some human errors in that part. So we could use AI robots for better accuracy and precision. So also, this robot can help on its own to learn and enable, because that's the best thing about AI. They can evolutionize themselves. They can learn from human activities and actions. So second applications could be packaging. Robotic packaging uses forms of AI frequently for quicker and lower cost and more accurate packaging. So AI also saves certain motions of a robotic system, which makes it really cost effective, installing and moving robotic system easy enough for everybody to do. So thirdly is customer service. We might have seen this in TV. We could think of various robots seen in Japan, which is used in a customer service capacity in retail stores and hotel around. The more they these systems interact with humans, the more they learn. And lastly is the open source robotics. This is an interesting segment in which robots are sold as an open source system with a specific application, such as, for example, a small scale agriculture may be taught to a robot and it will continue the rest. So this convergence of the open robotics with AI could be a huge trend in the future of AI robots. So next slide. Nextly, there are various AI robots evolutionary stages. So you could see four evolutionary stages. First one is reactive machines, limited memory, self-awareness, and theory of mind. So the first one, reactive machines, involves seeing the world directly. These machines do not keep any past memory and can't interactively participate in the world the way we imagine AI systems might. Instead, these systems will exactly do the same way every time, no matter what. So it's unlike the rest of them. Moving on to second one, the limited memory. And if I have to say, in developing AI robots, we are only in this stage. Unlike the reactive machines, they have very small memory and they do keep erasing themselves as the day progress. So a good example for this could be self-driving cars, could be an example. So as I already mentioned, we are only at this limited memory stage. We didn't move on to the next thing, that is theory of mind. Theory of mind, as you know, is a self-explanatory phrase of saying understanding the people, creatures, and objects in the world. Thoughts and emotions would definitely affect their behavior. And finally, is the most advanced robot enabling AI, is the self-awareness. And this is, could be also be called as the artificial super intelligent robots, in which this is the final stage of everything. Robots forms their representation about themselves. They build a machine like us, which by this time become ultimate supreme power of the world. So that's these are the four important evolutionary stages. So next slide, please. So there are a lot of advantages in the engineering perspective. AI has been used to ensure optimum reliability and accuracy in robots. So manufacturers in the robotics industry use AI intelligence to figure out appropriate time span for providing the maintenance of the robots. So customers avoid unnecessary breakdowns and associated costs of major repairs. So performances of these robots is enhanced by conducting in-depth analysis of data obtained from its sensors. So there is a probability of less errors that's been conducted in any field. So that's where these robots come into play. So also the final thing is the advantages could be it's an automated. It's even though it's highly accurate and fast, we can also use in many automation projects where robots are interconnected to various machines. So here AI is employed to analyze the data obtained from all the connected machines, that helping in optimizing the process. So next slide. So finally, the issues. We have seen in movies that AI overtaking the entire human world. So also many scientists and engineers say that we should quit studying and developing AI robots until a particular limit is reached. So I think you might all been familiar with the issues of WhatsApp and Facebook privacy and data security, which was a simple start to a wide range of problems. You could also see the Hindu article over there. There are a few questions to ponder about. How do we distribute the wealth created by the machines? How do we eliminate biases within different AI robots? How do we keep safer from external attacks like viruses? What if it surpasses us and change the world's control? So these are the questions to ponder about regarding AI's future development. So that's it for AI. So to sum it up, AI is a powerful technology which do help us in a lot many ways effectively, but does have a major consequences when it reaches its full potential. So it's up to us to make mature, sustainable care for this model. Otherwise, may be transformed into a massive destructive weapon. Thank you.
Hello. Good morning to all of you. Am I audible?
Yeah. Yes, Tathacharya. Yes, Tathacharya.
I am Narayana here, continuing with our presentation here. Today, I'm going to introduce you all about a few of the recent developments in robotics. So coming to our first robots, it's Pararobot. As Nirmal said, it's specifically one of such social robots, actually. Pararobots are basically advanced interactive robots. And it was developed by a Japanese intelligent system company, which are capable of simulating and giving emotional responses. So initially it was made as a cute harp seal and was used for just an extended application of animal assisted therapy. So what's animal assisted therapy? Then animal assisted therapy is a common way for reducing anxiety issues for patients who are suffering from illness like dementia, or for that matter, general relationship anxieties also. But use of robot over animal felt more beneficial because they will never get tired and can be more adaptable and calmer than any real pet. And also at the same time can be intelligent like a human. And based on studies and its application, Pararobot is found to reduce patient stress as it adapts and acts, socialize to emotions of the patients with using its own intelligence. A typical Pararobot has 5 kinds of sensors. Those are tactile, light, audition, temperature, and posture sensors, through which it perceives people and their environment. It will remember its action and will not commit if you dislike. That it can sense the direction of voice and can greet you too. It has some actuators inside it, which gives us the feel of movement of limbs so that we can feel it as a living animal itself. But apart from just psychological therapy, Paro has found to be very positive as a playmate for kids and old age people interacting and understanding their social behaviors. But again, there is a debatable concern over its growth and promotion, whether or not it is ethical to encourage a robot which is replaced as an illusion of real relationships, as they think it's not healthy to introduce a robot relationship, but should be limited to companionship only. Where can we go to next slide? Okay. Coming to our next robot, it's Sol Robot. It was created by a US Air Force in association with its hospital. It is capable of detecting microorganisms with its own intelligence. And as of now, it is functioned to detect around 22 microorganisms, including Ebola and then it can kill it with highly energetic fluorescent UV rays. It can kill in a range of 2 meters, but again, it will take 5 minutes for each 2 meter periphery. And also it is so precise that it can destroy just a single strand of RNA of a virus. It was used extensively in hospital and quarantine wards during Ebola outbreak and had an extremely positive impact. I just think over here, these kind of robots should also work in case of COVID and also be encouraged to suppress its dominance. I have recently gone through an article which mentioned few such updated robots were made in Trichy itself. I guess it was named Zaffy or something. Yeah, now coming to the third one, it's about soft exosuits. Is this slight change? Okay. As Pradesh mentioned about exoskeletons, for decades, engineers have built exoskeletons that used rigid links in parallel with the biological anatomy to increase strength and endurance in wearers and to protect them from injury and physical stress. But again, however, rigid exoskeletons often fail to allow the wearer to perform his or her natural joint movements. So, see, in case if there is a rigid object connected with your body, it can't always assist with your natural movement. Sometimes it has to give forces against your natural movement, which may cause pain and severe problems. So that's where exosuits can be widely used, and it assists elderly people and people with inability like Parkinson's disease to continue their natural movement and get assisted for their work. Not just this, it had found great application in easing the burden of soldiers, firefighters, factory workers, and farmers to carry extremely heavy load activities. So now coming to what makes it different from an exoskeleton. So it has structured functional textiles. These are just wearable suits. And these are designed such that these suits actually perfectly align with our muscle. So in case of a calf muscle, there will be some assisting artificial muscles aligned to our calf muscles itself. So this is the way they are designed. And these have light and very efficient actuations, which was actually lacking in exoskeletons. And apart from that, there are some integrated wearable sensors attached in suits itself. So it is stitched within the suits. Rigid exoskeletons usually include sensors such as encoders or potentiometers in robotic joints that accurately track joint angles, but these technologies are not compatible with soft structures. So here it is, the approach is to design new sensors to measure human kinematics and suit human interaction forces that are robust and that should be cost effective too. Majorly, the sensors used here are gyro, pressure sensors, and IMU. These sensors can be used as a part of control strategy for the wearable robot or alternatively to monitor and record the movement of the wearer. And these are like these can assist and detect the natural movement, and this is how it works. So yeah, that's all for my presentation.
Good morning, sir. My name is Nodu Rahul. I'm here to present a topic about humanoid robots in the latest development of robotic technology. Next slide. Right. Next slide. Introduction of humanoid robots. What is introduction of humanoid robots? Yeah, a humanoid robot is a robot with its body shape built to resemble the human body. The design may be for the functional purposes such as interacting with the human tools and the environment. As in the further, Pooja said, it is a manufacturing of the artificial intelligence. Similarly, humanoid robots are manufactured based on the artificial intelligence and the sensors and some of the other softwares. In general, humanoid robots have a torso, a head, two arms, and two legs. Though they form a humanoid robot, maybe a model of a part body. For example, from the waist part, it looks like human, and the under part looks like a machine. Some humanoid robots also have heads designed to replicate the human facial features such as eyes and mouth. There are two types of robots, humanoid robots. One is androids. These are the humanoid robots built to resemble a male human, and gynoids represent the female humanoid robot. And further, we will be knowing about the applications of humanoid robots. Next slide. Applications of humanoid robots. As we've seen in picture, humanoid robots have been helping humans in various stages. Humanoid robots has been used in fields of healthcare, education, and entertainment purposes. Moreover, humanoid robots have been playing a major role in human life, such as interacting with them socially and helping the people as friends, teaching, and assisting them in healthcare providing and then healthcare centers, as shown in the figure. Now let us discuss about the advantages of humanoid robots. There are many advantages of humanoid robots. Humanoid robots can perform any task that can be done by human beings. As long as the proper software aspects in the humanoid robots. Although they look reality, they have no physical sense with the object, with the human body. They can be used for the future space exploring mission. They can serve as companions and assistants for the human beings in the daily life. They can be used as ultimate helpers in man-made and natural disaster. Moreover, humanoid robots are used in various companies and manufacturing processes. A great development in science and technology leads to the advantages of humanoid systems that are rich and complex. Can also be an entertaining purpose. The humanoid robots are used for the teaching purposes and taking care of children in children care centers. And let us know about the disadvantages of humanoid robots. Next slide, please. There are also some disadvantages that are provided by the humanoid robots. The humanoid robots are very expensive, depending upon how advanced the robot is. Depending upon the robot, whether it is an artificial intelligence, the command mode, or the inbuilt software that was fixed to work. As the humanoid robots start becoming more and more available to the society, they become more expensive. Becoming more expensive, they lead to lack of jobs of lower class people and the lower income people. A lot of people will suffer from a lack of jobs. Lower people and middle class people, families will be affected by the robots. If you have these robots doing your work every day, and every job for us will become too dependent on robots. Thank you.
Yes. Do you have any clarification, any queries? Any queries? Any clarifications from your side? Okay. If you don't have any queries, then we'll wind up here. We'll meet tomorrow 11:30. Thank you. Thank you, Undal.